Okay, I want, like I said, let's ask God to open our minds, because again, I want to say it's like the understanding that I'm looking for. And if I can get one person to agree with me, then I'm happy. Go with me to Hebrews 8, verse 1. Heavenly Father, I thank you for opening our understanding and our minds tonight. Help us to see what you want to do on the earth. Help us to understand this way. Help us to understand your works, that we can know the counsel of your will, that we can know the purpose that you have for us. God, we are not interested in going around the mountain. I want to go up. I want to see your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so now he says, now of the things which we have spoken. Now this is the whole book of Hebrews is summed up in this verse. This is the sum. We have such a high priest who is set at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens. We have a high priest. Now please, the whole of the Old Testament was a man that was obeyed God, which started, there's the foundation of this world that was to prepare for the Christ to come. Moses was the builder, and he was given a pattern, and this pattern was for the body. But all of this was had to do with a priestly order, a kingdom of priests, and there was one high priest taken from amongst the men that would stand between God and man, that would bring man to God, the high priest. Now, this guy had to go through all these terrible cleansings to even go into this place where the ark was, where the mercy seat was covered, and the testimonies, three testimonies of life was covered inside. And there was a high priest that could only go in there. So what is the story of Jesus? Is this place is open and we can now freely enter it. Amen. So here he comes and he says, of everything, this is the sum. We have now such a high priest, a minister of the true sanctuary, the true tabernacle, which the Lord pitched and not man. So we need to understand this whole high priest thing. So I was in a car and I was trying to sleep, and these people wouldn't sleep. I wouldn't shut up that I can sleep, because I've been preaching, and I'm trying to sleep. And eventually I took my phone and I switched it on, and I'm putting my phone on my ear so that maybe I can sleep with a. And what I did is, oh my word, I put it on Hebrews 5. And Hebrews 5 goes on, I just want to read the portion where I jumped up and I never slept. I never slept, because he says, this Jesus is called of God, verse 10, 5 verse 10, called of God a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. Melchizedek. How do you say Melchizedek? Jesus is called a high priest after the order, everybody say order, of Melchizedek. And then he goes on, of whom we have many things to say, but it's hard to be uttered, seeing you are dull of hearing. For when the time ought to, you ought to be teachers, you have need that one teach you again the first principles of the oracles of God, and become such as have need of milk and not strong meat. Oh my word. Okay, here is a loop for another sermon. In the garden, there was a tree, and the fruit would be for meat. But they ate of the wrong tree. Now they had to dig the dust for bread. Then in this system, Moses comes and says, guys, the bread is going to rain from heaven. And the manna was the foreshadow of the Christ that's going to come. Come on. The first temptation, he said, let the stones be turned into bread. This was a system of stoning. If you don't keep this, they stoned you. And that's why the stone was rolled away. And that's why Daniel was a picture of Jesus, because he was thrown in the lion's den. And the king rolled the stone away and said, Daniel, did your God save you? Of course, man. Listen, if you see these patterns, for sure, for sure, for sure, everything God said is going to come out at the end. But you see, we've lost hope. We carry hope inside of us, but we're so confused in times. And we listen to every voice and everyone that preaches. We must go back to the Word. If I can just ring it out over and over and over, the Word will explain the Word. Don't make doctrines. Doctrines is in the Word. So now Jesus comes and he says, my meat is to do the will of the Father. Meat is for people that's obedience, because he became obedient unto death. For everyone that use milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, but strong meat belongs to them that are full age, even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised between good and evil. Because now we're in the world of knowledge, and it's like it's good and evil all the time. But there's a place where he says, I have overcome the world. So in him, we have overcome the world. But it's not our doing. It's not do, do, do. It's be, be, be. So do you stop working? No. Now you have a reason of working, because your doing comes out of your being. You don't do and become. You became and you do. Yeah. By grace are we saved through faith. It's a gift. It's not of ourselves. Unto, we are unto good works. So in other words, you can't say no work, no work. Come on, show me your faith. I'll show you my works and you'll see my faith. You see, we have to take the whole scripture and bring it in context. But here he says strong meat belongs to them. But he's like, guys, I want to teach you about Melchizedek, but you are babies. You're on milk. I jumped up. This is 2,000 years ago. And I remember in Bible school, this one says Melchizedek is Jesus. The other one says, no, it's a priest. The other one says it's a king. There's a program on YouTube where there's his palace is found. And everybody is like, what is Melchizedek? So obviously this is important, because he says the sum of everything is we have a high priest. What was the purpose of him? Okay, so when did Melchizedek come? Now the very next chapter, he says, let's go on to perfection, not laying again these foundations. And then chapter 7 says, for this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest, he's now telling us who is Melchizedek. Okay, now I just want to go back to chapter 5. And I'm just going to read something again that you get it, because I read it 6 times before I got it. Jesus is called, listen, high priest after the order of Melchizedek. It is an order. Okay. Now in chapter 7, he tells us who is Melchizedek, and Jesus came in the order of Melchizedek. For this Melchizedek, king of Salem, king of the Most High God, who met Abram returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him. Okay. The sum is we have a high priest.
Yeah.
Okay. All of this from here. The sum is we have a high priest. This high priest is now sitting at the right hand of the Father. This is how he came into being. And here he ascended and he's sitting at the right hand of the Father. Until the enemy is under our feet. So we have to understand, I'm going to say it again, the sum is we have a high priest who met Abraham after the slaughter of the kings. Come on. God created Adam. And God said to Adam, rule and have dominion. So what did Adam have? He had a crown. He was a king. He ruled in righteousness and he ruled in rest and peace. So what happened? He lost his crown. He lost his crown. And so after the flood, the first thing they did is they built a tower. We will be kings and we will have our crown. God said, no. What these people did, they scattered over the world and everyone started their own kingdom. And God said to Abraham, come out of them. I don't want you in this worldly kingdom. And in Abraham, we see why nobody ever preached this to me. I don't know. Genesis 17, verse 7. Abraham, I make a covenant with you. In your seed after you, and in your seed in their generation. But this generational seed will be a kingdom of priests with a high priest, preparing the high priest to come. This was the preparation of the body. But what did they say? We want a king. The dove left, the dung stayed, and they were taken to Babylon, which marked the beginning of their end. Okay, this is why I'm doing what I'm saying, because this morning what really came out to me is beginnings and endings, beginnings and endings. Everything has a beginning and an ending. Here's the beginning of creation. This will be the end of creation. This is beginning of time. This will be the end of time, and it's both there. You understand that? Everything is a beginning. Now, when this world began, something happened. Abraham was called out of the Ur of the Chaldees. And the next minute, Lot, that should not have gone with him, but it is his family. There was a big war. The whole promised land was full of people that were living there. It was giants. So what happened is there was four kings. Amraphel, Arioch, Chedorlaomer, and Tidal King of Nations. Now Chedorlaomer was the big guy. Can you see it's four? They ruled from Mesopotamia, all this place. They ruled it. And now they came in and they were furious because all the kings in the promised land that was supposed to be the promised land. Remember, Abraham was sojourning. This place was full of giants. Remember when Moses, come on, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, Moses, they didn't want to take the promised land because there was a few giants left. This is why God said, as sure as I, because I've already cleaned up the land for you and you don't understand what I've done. I love this. So Abraham, when he heard what happened, these four kings, they went in, they came in, they dealt with the Rephaims, the Zumzums, the Emmons, the Horites. They went, I don't know what year, they went to the Amalekites, the Amorites. Now, I want to read it to you. The Rephaims means giants. The Zumzums means the roving creatures. The Horites means the cave dwellers. The Emmons is terrors. The Amalekites and the Amorites were the descendants of Esau. It's the people that went the other way. Mm-hmm. It was the other side. Now what happened? These four kings came in, and they came in and they cleansed up the land. Then Abraham came in. They came here and they touched Abraham's family. They cleaned, they destroyed seven kingdoms. They cleaned them up. And then they touched Sodom, where Lot was. And Abraham took 380 servants and he went after them and he drove them right out, Dan, right out the country. So who cleaned, who actually cleaned the promised land of all these horror kings? These were horrible men. They were wild men. The world destroyed themselves because darkness is a path of self-destruction. Okay. Then Abraham went in for the cleaning. Come on, and he just chased them off. And they fell here at the Salt Sea in the slime pits, and he just overcame them, and he drove them right out the country. But they went on a self-destruction spree, and then Abraham came and cleaned it up. And as he came home, Melchizedek appears. Wow. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. No, no, no. You don't understand. Can we hear what the Spirit says? What does the Spirit say? He said to us, the end is set from the beginning. How many times did I say it this morning? When she sat at the table and she said, I'm like, what did the Spirit say to me? And I realized the end is set from the beginning. This is why I'm preaching what I'm preaching now. The end is set from the beginning. Nothing has caught God by surprise. So it doesn't matter how people change it. The end is set from the beginning. What is the end? Rest. The end will be rest. Yeah, but our country. Yeah, but God. There's a bigger but. So I want us to look from the sign of the side of the end is set from the beginning, because he says in Hebrews 4 verse 3, he said, my work is finished from the foundation of the earth, yet I swear they will not enter my rest. Okay, from the beginning, they fell short of the glory of God. They lost their crown. They fell short. But he says now in Hebrews, Hebrews is written, we're reading about there. He says, do not now come short of the rest. We must take heed. Go read Hebrews 2. He says, listen clearly to this message of Hebrews, that you do not come short of the rest. Because what happens, Jesus stepped in. And what he did, he came and he said, guys, I'm the Lord of the Sabbath. And they crucified him. So they cannot enter his rest. But we have to enter him, because rest came to us. This is why we don't keep the Sabbath. All the commands is written in our hearts. But it's a new command, because it's now in you and it's in him. In you and in him. He is our rest. And the end is always set, say it, the end is set from the beginning. Don't make doctrines in between. So let's look at it. So this is the beginning. This is the beginning when Melchizedek brought bread and wine. Now this was picked up by Jesus when he said, this is my body. This is my blood. So this is like a halfway stop and a reassuring, but the end of that is only coming here. What was the beginning? They destroyed themselves and Abraham wrapped it up. Yeah. And what happened? Bread and wine was served to him. Yeah. We have to understand what is bread and wine. Okay, now if we look at beginnings, Moses at the beginning of the law world. This is the end of the law world. Then they went to Babylon. This was the beginning of their end. Their end was here. Jesus came and he said, this is the beginning of miracles. What did he do? He turned water into wine. In other words, this beginning stepped right into that one, enforcing that the end will be sure. Oh, come on. Do you get what I'm saying? Isn't this awesome? Isn't it just awesome? So here is the beginning of the kingdom. The seed was planted. This is the end of the harvest. This is the beginning of the fountain opening up. You can now freely come drink. But this river is going to go so big that no church walls is going to hold people, because it's only the Spirit that's going to do it. Because it's going to be so deep that you can only swim there. You can't condor your ducks in a row. No fence is going to keep them in. The water is going to go over the fence and the ducks are going to mingle. It's already started. It's already started. Do you understand? Everything is the beginning. This is the beginning. This is his end. But this beginning is also an end. This beginning is also an end. This beginning is also an end. Everything is, never mind generations and life cycles, it's beginnings and endings. It's, if you have to draw everything, it's going to be a mess, because I don't know how to draw it. So how can I say, this is a beginning and an ending. This is the beginning and an ending, because Paul, here, it was the beginning of the opening of mysteries. The final mystery was opened that said, we shall not all die, but we shall all be changed, which leads us to the opening of the kingdom, which the end will be, we're not going to die, we're going to be changed. It's cycles. So every one of these is a cycle. Every one of these is a cycle. This is a cycle. This is a cycle. But the final end is the kingdom. What is the kingdom? The king of righteousness, peace, and the door is joy. Wow. We're going back to where Adam fell out. So what I said over and over this morning is the way God created it, day one, day two, day three, it's guarantees set in place. Everything that happens in God's purposes is guarantees set in place that the end will be raised. This is why Paul says, I will run my race. I will keep my faith. Because of time, people die. Yeah, but they preach immortality and they died. Because of time. Immortality is not something for you to achieve.
Yeah.
It's something you obtain.
Yes.
There's a big difference in achieve and obtain. Yes. We all run a race, but only one wins. Only one win. So run that you might obtain what Christ has already won. I'm not competing with you. This is what we have in the churches, is we're competing with who has the most miracles, who has the biggest churches. No. Christ has already won. So run that you might obtain. So run your race, keep your faith. So I just want to say, immortality, it says, seek glory, honor, and immortality. Honor, the body is sown in dishonor and it's raised in glory. Honor. So seek resurrection, glory, resurrection, and immortality. What is that? Life, life, life. What is that? Life, life, life. It's the testimony of Jesus inside of us. So when I seek it, seek the kingdom first not only, because the kingdom has to function in this place. Mm. You must do your job to a point where people can see Christ in you.
Come on.
Jesus is not our excuse. He is our reason. Do you get what I'm saying? Yeah. I've said a mouthful now, if we can just get it. We have to bring it right into this place. All of this is going to happen right here on earth. Earth is going to be restored because the glory of God is going to fill the earth. Where is this glory? And the knowledge of the glory is inside of us as a hope. Christ in us is the hope of the glory that's going to change the earth. And it's increasing and increasing and increasing and increasing. As time goes, revelation grows. And we have to start understanding that everything God has ever done is beginnings and endings, patterns, guarantees set in place, rhythms. It's like, it's better than algorithms. I think we call it holy rhythms or something. Because it's securing God's purpose. It's foreshadowing, fulfilling. And every time there's a fulfilling and a foreshadowing, it's a guarantee that nothing could stop it. Nothing can stop it. Nothing can stop it. And it's been coming from the beginning. But now, from the beginning of Abraham, we are called the children of Abraham. So what happened here is going to happen here. What is going to happen? The kings are going to destroy themselves. And we will go in to collect the spoils. But only those that can stand up and say, the king of Sodom came and said, okay, you have this, you have this. He says, I don't want nothing of you. Because nobody will say that you made me rich. I have succumbed to God. So here we have a little young man, 16 years old. He has just traveled about 1,200 miles, chained, 16 years old. Then he's called to stand in front of the king. They castrated him to stand in front of the king and be a eunuch. You had to be castrated. And then the table was set before him with the king's meat and wine. And he said, I will not defile myself. He was chosen number one. He was never called in number one. But he was a picture of the sons that will manifest at the end, that will not compromise, even if it costs your life. And you know what? If you're dead, it cannot cost your life because you're already dead. And to really climb this mountain, you have to sign to die. Okay. So now I still had a problem because I was in this book and I'm like, who is Melchizedek? Who is Melchizedek? Now we understand Melchizedek is the king of righteousness and the king of peace. Okay. The king of righteousness and the king of peace. Now, let me read the whole of Hebrews 5. For every high priest taken from among our men is ordained for men in the things pertaining God, that he may offer both gifts and sacrifices for sin. Who can have compassion on the ignorant? Is that not amazing? Compassion on the ignorant. And on them that are out of the way, for that he himself also is compassed with infirmity. By reason hereof, as for the other people, so also he for himself to offer sins, that no man take this honor unto himself, but he is called of God as Aaron. Also Christ glorified not himself to be made a high priest, but it is said, thou art my son, today I have begotten you. And he was the only begotten of the Father. Meaning, he said, he came from the bosom of the Father. When he arrived on the earth, he said, I am the only begotten. When he rose from the dead, he was the first begotten, because I'm also now begotten. I'm also in that lineage. He says, and as he saith also in another place, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. He said in another place, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. What is that other place? We're going to go there just now, but let's go on. Who in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplications with strong crying and fears unto him that was able to save him from death. Melchizedek has to do with death. And was heard in that he feared. Though he were a son, yet he learned obedience by the things he suffered. Oh, do you know what I go through? I really don't want to know, because yours is a picnic against mine. What is the church? It's a club where everybody is having a moaning competition. Who's got the worst situation? Feel sorry for me. Okay. And being made perfect, he became the author of eternal salvation unto them that obey him. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ, who became obedient unto death. You see, but we don't want to die. How do you die? We don't have to physically die. We become living sacrifices. We become a living sacrifice by the renewing of our mind. I die to my will, because he said, not my will, your will be done. Oh my God. Called of God, a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. Now, I want you to go with me to chapter 2. He says, therefore, now just remember chapter 8, verse 1, the sum of everything is we have a high priest. All of this, from here, all of this, beginnings and endings, is for one thing. We have a high priest that's going to bring us there. No matter how men failed, no matter how they messed up, we have a high priest. And Satan couldn't stop him from coming. So he's not going to stop him from fulfilling his purpose. This is not our work. It's his purpose. AIs are not going to stop him. Okay. Can we have it a little colder? It's so hot here. Are you also hot or not?
It's hotter than it was.
Yeah, I'm boiling. Oh, thanks. Okay, verse chapter 2. Therefore, we ought to give more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest any time they should slip us by. In other words, it says, don't get caught up in all this nonsense you hear. Stay in the Word. Stay with us. We have a high priest. The sum is we have a high priest. We're going to reach our destiny. For if the word spoken by angels was steadfast, to every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of the reward. Now, God gave Moses the command, but angels gave him the plan of the law. So this is where the law judgment came in of stoning. This is why he says, if the word spoken by angels, how shall we escape if we neglect such a great salvation, which at first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed to us by them that heard him? God also bearing them witness, both with signs and wonders, divers miracles and the Holy Ghost, according to his own will. For who of the angels did he ever put in subjections the world to come, whereof we speak? And he says in chapter 1, to whom of the angels did he ever call his son? So don't come out with the angels in Genesis 6 came to the daughters of man. No, angels were not sons. It was the sons, the seed line of Seth, that went to the seed line of Cain. This is where the giants came from. But one in a certain place testifying, saying, "What is man that thou art mindful of him?" This is Psalm 8. "Or the son of man that you visit him. You made him lower than the angels and crowned him with glory and honor and did set him over the works of your hands. Thou hast put all things in subjection under his feet. For in that he put all things in subjection under him, he left nothing that was not put under him." Where was this? You crowned him, yeah, with glory and honor, and you put all things in subjection. But now we don't see it, but we see him. One verse, can you see one verse takes us through all these lines? You have crowned him, but now we don't see it. Mm-hmm. Why? Because he threw away his crown, he fell. And Jesus came into this situation, picked up, and he is now seated at the right hand. Come on. We see him. The sum is, we have a high priest. You know, what's he going to do? He's going to sit there till all the AIs have smashed everybody up and all the kings have destroyed everybody and the wealth of the wicked is going to come to the just. Come on. And the glory of God is going to fill the earth. How is it going to happen, Annalise? Like rain. He says, "I will give you the former rain moderately and the former and the latter in one," because this is the due season. This is the generation of Christ. It's one period with small periods, beginnings and endings, working towards God's purpose of eternity. Isn't that awesome? Oh, my word. But now we see not all things under him, but, here's the big but we see Jesus made lower than the angels for his suffering, for the suffering of death. He was crowned with glory and honor, that he by the grace of God, grace worked from Noah. By the grace of God, it worked in him. It prepared him to taste death. Oh my God. He's now crowned with glory and honor. What is honor? Resurrection. The body is sown in dishonor, raised in glory and honor. Honor is a full circle. It's a ring. It's a ring. This is why the Spirit and the Bride is going to meet again. Come on. That by the grace of God, he should taste death for every man. For it became him whom are all these things, by whom are all things in bringing many sons to glory. Sure, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through suffering. For both he that sanctified and they that are sanctified are all of one, which cause he's not ashamed to call them brethren. So we also come from the bosom of the Father. We have the same Spirit that cries, "Abba, Father." There's a sermon I wanted to preach. If you do not have the doctrine of Christ, you are none of his, and you do not have the Son and the Father. They came. They said, "What new doctrine have you brought?" Because Jesus Christ is to come. In the was, it was the law and the prophets. The law and the prophets. In the east, it's the Father and the Son. In the east to come, it's the Spirit and the Bride. The new doctrine is the Father and the Son. And we have the Spirit crying, "Abba, Father," saying, "I will declare thy name unto my brethren." In the midst of the church, I will sing praise to thee. And again, I will put my trust in him. And again, behold, I and the children which God have given me. For as much as the children are partakers of flesh and blood. Everybody say flesh and blood.
Flesh and blood.
Flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. So he came into this sinful thing. God commanded his son in the guise of sinful flesh to condemn sin in the flesh because he offered his blood in obedience. Oh my God. He also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had power over death, that is the devil. So is he destroyed or isn't he? Yeah, but he's walking like a roaring lion. No, guys, he's walking here like a roaring lion. He's having his final fit, trying to kill the infant church. We're not fighting him. We have to understand the lions. And I'm telling you, if you say to people, he's not your roaring lion, people get very cross because then we've got no one to blame. He might destroy him that had the power over death, that is the devil. Okay, but death is still working. Because we're in the realm of death. This is the realm of death, darkness and death. But light is inside.
Yes.
And light will drive darkness out.
Amen.
So do you understand what's going to happen when what is happening here gets here?
Yes, thank you.
Death has to go. And he is the high priest sitting there waiting till the last enemy is under our feet.
Amen.
For verily he took not in on him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham. Can I just say here? He did not take on him the order of angels. He took on him the order of sinful man. Now he is raised in the order of God himself. What is that? Image and likeness. King of righteousness, King of peace.
Yes.
Melchizedek is King of righteousness, King of peace. Jesus is now raised in the order of King of righteousness and King of peace. He's crowned with glory and honor, as which is man was crowned with glory and honor. He received the crown and the glory and the honor because he went right within the veil and he already got the crown for us. Mm. And he's waiting for us to get it here. Wherefore, in all things, it behooved him to be made like his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest pertaining to God, to make reconciliation for the sins of the people. For in he himself suffered being tempted. He is able to secure them that are tempted. This is why we have a high priest. There's nothing that I have to bow to. There's nothing I can go through. I was sitting in the airplane and I'm thinking, I gave up so much. I lost so much. And it just came up in me, compared to Christ, I've not lost anything. Compared to Christ, I've not offered up anything. If we can just understand, God himself is securing my position in him. Yeah, but, well, I've got lots of buts, but his butt is bigger. Do you understand? So what is he doing there? He is securing us for what? For to finally step into the rest. What is the harvest? What is the restoration of creation? I love creation. It's so beautiful outside. Can you imagine what it's be?
Yeah.
When perfection comes, do you know who's going to speak it in? Us. But unless we keep the bitter here and start prophesying light here. Come on. Isaiah 5:5 says, Israel, they exchange light for darkness, darkness for light. Good for evil, evil for good. Bitter for sweet, sweet for bitter. Revelation, everything is opened that was sealed. Moses had to seal their destruction, and God said, I seal it in my treasuries. Here they sang the song of Moses, and it was open. Daniel had to seal what he saw. Here the seals were broken, and it was open. You see the seals, the trumpets, the vials. Everything is open. Revelation 22, he says, don't seal anything in this book. Yet, Revelation 10, the angel of God is revealed. He's got a rainbow around his head, the mark of God. You know what's the mark of God? Creation will be restored. He's got one foot on the sea, one foot on the land. There's no more Jew, no more Gentile. His legs were cloudy pillars. Oh my God. He's the one that came with them through the desert. He was the rock that followed them in the desert. His face was brighter than the midnight sun. He's the book that has just been opened, because Isaiah, he prophesied here and he said, the vision is now as a book that is sealed because your eyes are closed. But it's now open, because he says, who will open the book? The lion out of the tribe of Judah took the book and opened it. He's the book that was written within and on the back. And now it's opened and you can literally see it. What's going to happen? So here, he's the book and he stands there. And there's seven thunders. Decrees. No lightning. No revelation. These decrees made for seven church periods. But no revelation on it. It's not written down. He says, eat the book. It's sweet in the mouth. It's bitter in the belly. This is a lonely road. This is not an easy road. It's not easy, but it's so glorious. Amen. If you can just keep the sweet, the bitter, the body will work it out. Yeah. Don't let the bitter come out here. It's not supposed to come out here. Wow. Forget them. Forget everybody. I don't expect anybody to walk with me. I don't expect anybody to like me anymore. I've signed to die. I'm not getting off, because there's a scripture. He says, who will ascend up into the hill of the Lord? And he says, in Psalm 84, in the Message Bible, he says, how blessed are those whose lives become the road he travels. I don't know. I come out of crowds and crowds of people, and I've been through everything where everybody throws everything at you. I will not exchange that for one time that I have with God in the Word. But you see, it's going to be a work of God. He will take me and He will put me. It's not my doing. Yeah. And you know what, Chalapi? When He puts you, everybody will say, how did she get there? I mean, God knows. I don't know. Do you understand what we're in? But don't ever underestimate who you are, what you're busy with, and what's happening to you. Because the very fact that you hear, and you hear the Word, if he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says. Yeah. The sum of all of this is we have such a high priest. And he's waiting. So there is a little issue for me, because he says it in Psalm 2, in Psalm 110, Hebrews 2, Ephesians 1, I think he says in Colossians, and he's seated at the right hand of the Father. He's seated at the right hand of the Father. But when Stephen was stoned, the persecution started, the battle started. And as he was dying, he looked up and he saw Jesus standing at the right hand. And it marked the time of standing. Standing. This is the time when you've done all you can to stand. Stand, stand, stand. Satan is walking like a roaring lion. Stand. Do all you can to stand. But there's a promise waiting for the children of God that we have not seen. So I have learned all my life. Ephesians says, put on the whole armor of God. And when you've done all you can to stand, stand. Mm-hmm. My husband just told me, never sit down. I'm standing. I'm standing sometimes so hard that I cannot stand anymore. But I refuse to sit down, and I've seen something crazy in the Bible. And I think it's time that we step into what David, when David stepped into it, he said, goodness and mercy will follow me. He was not talking about this time that he lived in. He's talking about this time. Because he says, I will dwell in the house of the Lord, not the house of Moses. Yeah. Come, Isaiah said, where is the house that you would break build for me? Jesus said, break this thing down. What did he say in Psalm 17? I will awake with your likeness. So there's another thing that he says in Psalm 23 that you pick up in Revelation 2. He says, I'm standing at your door. Jesus is the door to life. But he's standing at your door, your mind, your house. He says, if you let me come in, I've always wondered about this. I will come and we will sup. Now, I don't know if you really go and have a nice supper. You sit down and enjoy if you're really hungry. He says, I will lay a table before you in front of your enemies.
Yes.
We're not going to stand anymore. We have to start sitting down and enjoying Jesus, because there is no way we can change the earth. It's not going to be our work.
Wow.
It's not going to be our doing. Our doing is now do, whatever it is. Do you understand? It's not going to count. We have to sit down and start enjoying Him.
Yes.
Come on, guys. There's nothing like if you really hunger and it's a really good mood, food. It's like, wow. I was just with people in California, this guy, I promise you, we're busy with breakfast, then he wants lunch. He's already thinking what we're going to have for lunch. He's busy with lunch and he thinks, what are we going to have for supper? I'm like, there's something wrong with you. He says, no, I like the taste of food. And I think we have to get a taste for the things of God.
Yes.
Come on.
Yes. Come on.
There's nothing like it, but we can't stand around. We're going to, oh, I like it, like how they do it in the Middle East. Oh, my God. Suddenly I saw this picture. There's a prophecy that went over me and Quibbers. He said, you will be like a watered garden whose waters fail not. And I was at a very, very difficult time in my life. I was in a Arab Emirates in Dubai, and this guy said to me the morning, I had a dream about you last night. I've got a word for you. I said, leave me alone. I don't want any word. I'm just, if I see a prophet, I run. Mm-hmm. I don't want anything. Mm-hmm. I just don't want to hear, because usually it's, I'm going to do this with you, but I don't tell you what you're going to go through. And before we were married, the prophecy came to us. I made a big placard. It's in our church. You will be like a watered garden where the waters fail not. I cannot even tell how many times I've taken it and said, Lord, you said it. And I'm in Dubai, and he said to me, come, I'm going to take you into the desert. We go into the desert about 100 kilometers. It's just sand. And there's this beautiful, beautiful oasis and hotel. And you don't sit at the table, you lie next to the table, you know. And there's these curtains hanging in the wind, and it's all the tables are on the top of the hotel. And there's the camels, and the, it's like, so, and he says, it's time to give you your word. In the middle of the desert, he says, God said you will be like a watered garden whose waters fail not. What? Do you understand? What is the guarantees of God? When you start understanding the Bible, you cannot but kiss the word. Because what he said is going to come out. And all these people that act like idiots changing the word of God, it doesn't even bother me anymore. Because I realize his word is set in the heavens. He's patiently waiting for us to step into it. How is it going to come? It's going to come like rain, Chalopi. You're going to walk and say, it's raining. No, it's not raining. Yes, it's raining. Yeah, I can feel. Run, it's raining. Do you get what I'm saying? Run, it's raining. How's it going to happen? It might be our generation. We might be part of it. Maybe we're not. I don't know. What does it matter? The guarantees of God is set in the heavens. The end is set from the beginning. What did God say this whole day to us? The end is set from the beginning. What does he say? The sum of everything is we have such a high priest. In the order of Melchizedek. What is the order of Melchizedek? Come on, it's John 1 tells us, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. The Spirit Word came from the bosom of the Father. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. So that Spirit Word, from this time, heaven was opened. Ezekiel saw it, a man, an ox, an eagle, and a lion. Heaven is the headquarters. Earth is where it's worked out. What is it? The Spirit Word took on the form of man. He went right down. He emptied this place. And now he's back with the Father in the order of the Father. Word with word. Oh, come on. He already is crowned with glory and honor. We don't see man anymore crowned with glory, but we see Jesus. Why? He is our high priest. Why? Very soon, we're going to be crowned with glory and honor. We're going to step back into all this confusion. It's going to be gone. You know, he says, we do not mourn like someone that has no hope. I tried to kill myself because I couldn't. I'm never going to see his face again. You never hear his voice again. What happened? Till you understand the word and you realize, oh, all we can do is pave a way for others to come. If you ever hear I'm gone, don't cry one bit, dance and celebrate. Because my life was a life worth living. Maybe I'm alive for just one person. I am not interested in the crowds. I'm alive maybe for one, because I realize the sum of everything is we have such a high priest. So this realm from the cross here, this is a crazy realm, because at least here they were darkness and they were dumb. They ate children. They had 100,000 wives. Can you imagine Solomon got me in his harem? Man, I would have created so much hell for that woman. It's just not true. You know, it's like you now sort of know. The law is inside of us. Why is the law of the Sabbath not inside of us? Because he became the Lord of the Sabbath. Can you imagine how big this guarantee is that rest came to us? Grace came to us, and he put the guarantees inside, and he sealed it so that we can just enter into it. Yeah. But no, our minds, you know, we want to do it this way. Just get out of your mind. Get out of your mind. Get into the Spirit.
Yes.
We have a high priest. Why? Because he's not going to give creation to the demons. Please, this time here is a crazy, crazy time. Here was the gross darkness. The gross darkness is not over, but we are still in the realm of darkness with heaven opened on us. We're in the same plane with two realms working in us. And it looks like darkness is winning. But darkness is a road of self-destruction. Can we go through the patterns of the Bible? They tried to follow God's people through the sea. What happened? The biggest kingdom was destroyed. The water just closed in on them. Why is that? He says these are patterns for us. It's not going to be the great and the mighty ones. It's going to be those that will be able to trust God, those that are on the mountain. Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, they were thrown in the fire. They came out not even smelling like fire. The others all died. He says, you will go through the water. You will go through the fire. But you know what? When the fire comes to us, like, pray for me. I'm like, pray for yourself now. Really, I've added. This one lady, she was raped when she was 6. And she's now nearly 60. And every time she sees me, oh, pray for me. I was raped when I was 6. I'm like, get over it. Pray for yourself. I'm not tired of you. You know what? Just struggle if you want to struggle. The mountain is sometimes a lonely road where people don't understand you. But you know what, God? We have a high priest that has compassion for those who are ignorant. I can't be your high priest. I can only step into what I have to step into. You see, we are so busy doing God's work. My sister, I prayed for her for like 40 years. And one day I said to God, she can now go to hell. I'm not going to pray for her again. The next day she phoned me and I led her to God. When we give up, he doesn't give up. He's the high priest.
Amen.
My God, please. A whole generation babies was murdered. A whole generation babies was murdered. A whole generation of the early church, infant church, only one came through. And the daughter of Zion that fled Jerusalem came through. Come on. Do you think this is not going to happen? Do you understand? God's Spirit is working through all this chaos because out of chaos, he said, let there be light. And then when the darkest, this was the darkest, darkest. Here it was dark, but here creation killed the Creator. Yeah. What? The darkest day ever. His government was in place. He knows exactly what he's doing. And though it looks like, we are going through a very dark time because it's a whole change of season. The world is going darker. You guys have no idea how dark it is outside there. But we have a high priest. When did the high priest appear? When the kings eliminated all the kings. And Abraham just went in for the spoils. What did he do? He brought bread and wine. Please. Jesus turned bread, he turned water into wine, saying, this is the beginning of miracles. But the crushing is the wine. The crushing is the wine. So here's something I saw the other day. The night he was betrayed. He thanked God and he broke the bread. He thanked God. He broke the bread and gave it to them. He drank the cup and gave it to them. He didn't fall apart. Then he went to the garden. And in the garden, he said, this cup, no, let it pass from me.
Yeah, it could not have been the same cup.
It could not have been the same cup. Because he says in Hebrews, for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. Mm-hmm. But you know what? The Bible talks about the treading of the winepress. He sat here and he said to Jerusalem, what more could I have done for you? Jerusalem, the vine was God's plan. Come on, have you read Isaiah? God planted a vineyard on a very fruitful hill. He did everything. He did everything for them. He knew now the crushing was going to come on them. I could never understand it when I read in Revelation. He talks about the wrath of the lamb. I thought, he must have talked about the wrath of the lion. He talks about the wrath of the lamb. He knew he had to crush them. This is why this is the coming of the Son of Man. And this is the cup that he said, my God, let this pass from me. He said, but if it needs be. So all of this, he took the crushing for my joy. He crushed them for my joy. And I want to be in the kingdom with a long face because of what I went through. Oh my gosh. The kingdom is righteousness, peace, and joy is the door. For the joy that was set before him, he took the cross. He cried because of what was going to happen to these people. Why? He turned on his own plan to bring us the kingdom. Sure. And we want to restore that. No, no. We're going to step into bringing life to nations again. Come on. How do we do it? By being, not doing. By being, by understanding the word and becoming him. You don't have to do anything to become him. He did it for you. We want to do, 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 do. And that is what it is do-do. In South Africa, do-do is sleep. Do you understand? It's like he's not impressed with us. It's being. It's being. In the beginning, God wanted us to be. The minute you try to be, you're not hearing the Spirit. You're out of the Spirit totally. Can we go now to where he says in Psalms 110? Man, I love preaching. He says, oh my God, listen to this. This is David. Jesus, son of David. David had to commit adultery. David had to commit murder because he was the one that got the revelation of mercy. Mercy before they went to Babylon even. His whole life was, he lived not in his time, he lived in this time. Because mercy only came by Jesus Christ. That is why this was a shadow of death. He opened the door and everybody, oh please, Bathsheba is the well of the seventh oath promise of God. So I went and looked at Bathsheba. Abraham and Abimelech were having the scramble over wells. And they were stealing his wells. And then Abraham dug a well, but there came so much water out. He offered seven lambs. And Bathsheba is the well of the seventh oath promise of God, meaning when Jesus died, he died not only for these people, he died for everybody that was ever born. It's a well. It comes from beneath. Is that not awesome? Okay. Psalm 110. The Lord said to my Lord. Now you understand it. Sit thou at my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool. Heaven is my throne. Earth is my footstool. The Lord shall send the rod out of thy strength, out of Zion. Rule in the midst of thy enemies. Come on. You know what is Zion? Zion is the church. He will send his rod out of the strength of Zion. Rule in the midst of thine enemies. Thy people this is the people I'm preaching to. I don't want to preach to other people. Thy people shall be willing in the day of thy power. Come on, let's get it. The end is set from the beginning. This man with 380 servants, he did it. And he conquered everything and he took back what was his. He says, now it's going to be the day of our power. The day of his power. The Lord shall send a rod out of the strength, out of Zion. Zion is the church. Rule in the midst of your enemies. Thy people shall be willing in the day of your power, in the beauty of holiness. From the womb of the morning, thou hast the dew of youth. Listen, what is the morning? This is the morning. This is the morning. This is 12 o'clock. This is the morning. It has been coming long. It's time that we take it. Come on. The Lord at thy right hand. Please get what David said. I will lay a table before you in front of your enemies. Darkness is a path of self-destruction. You won't have to lift a finger. You shine the light. The purpose of creation was light in darkness. Light in darkness came in the beginning. Light in darkness came in the fullness of time. And the minute you say yes to Jesus, light comes right into darkness. Let the light just shine. Get it here. All you have to do is get this here. He says, the Lord at thy right hand shall strike through the kings in the day of his wrath. He shall judge among the heathen. He shall fill the places with dead bodies, and he shall win the heads of many over many countries, and he shall drink of the brook by the way. Therefore shall he lift up the head. Wait. He is the head. He stroke through the kings. What was the brook, by the way? The Spirit. And he will lift up the head. And he is now the head of the body. And he's waiting until our enemies be our footstool. The last enemy to be tread on is death. Behold, we shall not all die, but we shall all be changed. Revelation 14:13 says, blessed are those that die in Christ. They rest from their labor and their work follow them. So death is just an extra change. Everyone that has ever gone before us is waiting for our awakening. I was looking at the timelines I was making the other day. There was a first awakening, a second awakening, and God said to me, the third awakening is about to break. And I listened somewhere, and the guy is preaching about the third awakening. I'm like, whoa, okay. So there is people that are here. Come on, guys. What the eye have not seen, what the ears have not heard, what has not come up in the heart of man. This is why I've made this beginning and endings here. What, this was a refreshing, this will be the end. This was a refreshing, this is it. My life started here, and what I have seen here, Oral Roberts said, our church has seen more miracles than all the healing revivals together. Maybe alive, I'm the person that has seen the most miracles. I had to be in every service. It's only a drop in the bucket of what's coming. Don't grab back like this Jesus Revolution film. Guys, this was about here. What that happened. Don't grab back. It's a shadow of what's coming. When you see anything of the past, you can say, that's just a drop in the bucket of what's coming. What is going to happen? I've shown you over and over its patterns, beginnings, endings. What it started there was infused here, and it will be one great finale. The beginning of earth, the end of earth. Beginning of the world, the end of the world. Beginning of a world, the end of the world. Beginning of a world that will never end. The only thing that will never end is inside of you. But all we do is work for everything on the outside. Time is what we have to prepare for eternity. Every minute wasted is gone. I am so ashamed of myself to be in that great ministry for so long, and the Word, I spend time doing everything but reading the Word. And I tell you what, I am not willing to waste one second of my days anymore, because every step I give on this mountain is towards the goal. How blessed are those whose lives become the road he traveled. They go up into the mountain. They come upon pools brimming with rain. But around the last corner, Zion, God in full view. Whether we make it here, whether we're going to step into it, we have a high priest. I just want to say something. You know, when Moses came to the country, to the promised land, they said, no, we don't want to take it. There's giants. The land was already cleaned up. There was just a few left, and they wouldn't take it. Come on. This is when Abraham was there. The land was already cleaned up of the Zumzuns and the Rephaims and the Emmons and the Horites. The land was already cleaned up, and they wouldn't take it. Can I say something? The price is already paid. We're just going to step into it. We're in darkness. We're in darkness. It's horrifying around us. But the price is already paid. If I go to any place and the price is paid, I don't care. I just walk in.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you that you will never leave us. You will never forsake us. You will never, ever let go of us or lose your grip on us. I thank you, God, that every one of us here is going to step into what you have for us, because from the beginning to the end, it is set in the heavens and no one's going to change it. I thank you for complete healing for everyone in this place. And also our sister that was here today. Lord, I pray that you will touch that body of hers. And cancer cells will die. Doctors will be amazed. We want to see, oh God, what the eyes have not seen. We want to hear what the ears have not heard. God, I thank you that we will just step into what you have for us. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.